much, and good afternoon. And thank you to the English department and the New York University for this privilege of interacting with you in, as Prof has described, a class and not a public lecture. But I can see that members of the public have invaded the classroom. but I guess that knowledge is shared, and so you are all warmly welcome. Let me thank Prof. Anyido and Dr. J for the organization that has gone into this. And to recall, as Prof. Anyido just told you, that I was here several years ago, and he's told you the story. At the time, the book was still a manuscript. I started writing this book in 2001. And I didn't think that it would ever be published. My dad had died in July of that year, no, in June of that year. And after the funeral, my brothers and myself, my brothers and I used to come together. I just recollect the experiences we had with my dad. And it struck me that I should just keep a diary of some of those things so that I could share them with my children in future. That's how the book started. And so it started as a personal manuscript, and I just kept putting recollections of things my dad had told me, conversations with my brothers, and all that, until I met my very close friend, who eventually became my editor for this book, Nana Madankwa. And Nana Madankwa is a friend and colleague of Prof. Anyido, and they're quite close. And so it was between her and Prof. Anyido that organized the first, reading that I did here. But the way it became a book, I was having a chat with Nana. She's a writer, prolific writer. And I was having a chat with her. And she says, I mean, African leaders don't document, their experiences and stories. And she says, John, I hope you would break from this tradition. Why don't you write your experiences and all that? And I said, look, I don't have the time. She says, you can find the time if you want to do it. And I said, anyway, I have this manuscript, that documents a portion of my life. Man, I don't know who would be interested in reading these silly experiences of small boys and all that kind of thing. And he said, oh, okay, can I take a look at it? And that's when my troubles began. As soon as Nanama took a look at it, I had done the first story, my first coup d'etat, what had happened after the coup. And she read it, and she said, but the world would like to know this, because this is a period of Ghana's history that is not very well documented. We have a lot of authors who have written about pre-independence and immediate post-independence. But in the period that Africa fell into the doldrums, especially Ghana, into the economic pits, they were the hardest years of our country's history. In 1983, for those of you who lived it, you will know that we had nowhere else to go deeper. We had reached the bottom. And so she said, people haven't written and documented this period. And so this manuscript will be one of the few that shows that even though countries were going through these reversals, young people were growing up, young people were having a nice time, young people were facing their challenges and all that. The rest is history. So I started expanding the manuscript, and she helped me with a lot of the editing. And eventually Bloomsbury gave us a book contract, and finally the book was produced. This is my author's copy. You can see it's a very well-thumbed copy. I've read it in many events like this. And like Prof said, we did a six-nation tour of the United States promoting the book. We were supposed to do a promo in Ghana, in Accra, Kumasi, Ho, and Tamale. But unfortunately, the events that he just narrated happened, and I became president of this country, and I never ever found the time to promote the book again. And so maybe these are new beginnings. Bloomsbury will be very happy to see me promoting it, because then they can make some more money, selling the book. But we had planned also to go to East Africa to do a book launch in Nairobi, in Nigeria, and in South Africa. And so maybe now that the MC says I look well and I have more time on my hands, I can take up from where we left off. I'll just read a few excerpts, and then in the interaction I can tell you more about what went into the style and everything of doing this book. It's been very difficult to choose which excerpts because different people have their different parts, their favorite ones. The story of the bully Prof talked about is a hit with a lot of people because most people have passed through secondary school and they've encountered their own bully, and so they see themselves, you know, in my shoes when they read this particular story. A lot of women and girls like Praise for the Powerful because it talks about the first time I fell in love and the romance that I went through, the letters I wrote and all that. So I was torn, you know, as to which excerpts to read. But what I've done is I've taken bits and pieces of several chapters and I'll just read through those. And after that, we can expatiate on it more. Thank you very much. So the first one is my first coup d'etat, and the book takes its title from that story. The book is divided into chapters. Each chapter is a story on its own. And so a friend of mine told me, when I'd given him the book and he had read it, he said, I like the way the book is structured. You can read it from the beginning to the end, or from the middle to the beginning and to the end, or from the end to the beginning, whichever way you want to read it, you can read it, because each chapter is self-fulfilling in itself. So here goes, and it comes from my first coup d'etat and other stories from the lost decades of Africa. In fact, all of Africa experienced a brain drain, a mass exodus that found many of our artists, intellectuals, professionals, and politicians living abroad in either a forced or self-imposed exile. As a result, that period of time and the direct impact it had on the cultural, educational, and political lives of those who remained has not been heavily documented, especially not from a personal perspective. There are years that are rarely discussed, years of untold difficulty and hardship, of ever-present danger and fear. There are years that many have understandably tried to forget or to erase entirely from memory. But rarely is anything all bad. There are always pockets of light, however small, to be found during periods of darkness. A number of us who stayed behind during the lost decades and lived through the difficulties, whether by choice or by force, discovered that it was ironically during this time that we found ourselves and found our voices. For many individuals, there's a moment that stands out as pivotal to the awakening of their consciousness. Often that moment can feel like a harbinger of disaster. The first tremors of an earthquake or rains of a hurricane, the eruption of civil war or riots, an assassination or a coup d'etat. It is a moment that serves as the line of demarcation, separating the certainty of what was from the uncertainty of what lies ahead. It is a moment in which you suddenly become aware of who you are. You become aware of the fragility and unpredictability of the world in which you live. Ghana's descent into the lost decades began with such a moment, with the coup d'etat that unseated our first president, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. When I look back on my life, it is clear to me that this moment marked the awakening of my consciousness. It changed my life and influenced all the moments that followed. The lost decades from that first coup d'etat to the final reintroduction of constitutional rule were the years that defined my life, and as a result, they are the years that I have wanted most to write about, to commit not only to memory, but to paper. It was my desire through the stories in this book to document the effects that the events that occurred during those years had on the country, and more personally and specifically on my family and me. Doctor, it happened on February 24th, 1966. I was 7 years old, a class two pupil in the primary division of Achimota, an elite boarding school in Accra, Ghana's capital. That day, there was a lot of commotion. Teachers rushed about in a noticeably scattered fashion. They huddled in corners, whispering. It did not take long for the news to spread, first through the upper school student body, then down to the younger pupils. The words I heard people speaking that day seems to hold a certain air of mystery and urgency, especially that phrase, coup d'etat, which was being repeated often like a mantra. I had never heard it before. Yet I knew without me having to be told that it did not belong to any of the six languages I spoke. Not Gonja, not Twi, not Hausa, not Dagbani or Ga, or not even English. To my child's ear, the phrase sounded exciting, like a game that all the upper form students will soon be playing. And from the moment I first heard it, coup d'etat, I wish I could learn and know how to play this game as well. The day after the coup, once the initial flurry of fear and excitement had passed, our teachers explained that it wasn't a game after all. The phrase coup d'etat apparently meant the government has been overthrown. Even in plain English, the concept seemed nonsensical to me. How can you overthrow an entire government? And what exactly are you throwing it over? Days passed. The news became more precise, and I began to piece bits of information together. While our president, Osagyefo Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, was on an official visit to North Vietnam, the military had seized control of Ghana. Dr. Nkrumah was Ghana's first president. He was a true visionary. At the time, it was fairly commonplace for Ghanaian intellectuals to travel to Europe to complete their education and receive their advanced degrees. Dr. Nkrumah opted instead to attend institutions in the United States, receiving his undergraduate degree at the Lincoln University and his graduate degree at the University of Pennsylvania. At Achimota, we heard that all the ministers of state had been arrested. This particular bit of information gave me pause, because my father was a minister of state. Even so, I don't think I was able to fully absorb all the implications. Not then. Perhaps it was because I had not received word from my family that anything was wrong. Or it might have been because I felt, as children often do, that my family and I were somehow shielded automatically from anything tragic. The coup d'etat became real to me, an event that constituted more than words. In early April, when my school vacated for the Easter holidays, and nobody came to pick me up, I watched as all the other children left with their relations, room after room of each dormitory was emptied of its occupants, until mine were the only footsteps in the halls, and still no one came. That's the excerpt from the my first coup d'etat. thank you very much. I'll take another excerpt, and this one from the chapter titled Teenagers in Tamale. When I finished my primary education in Achimota, at the time, for those of you who are too young, we had an exam we called the Common Entrance Examination. And our first competitive exam was in class 6. You took the exam, and depending on your performance and the choice of school, you were thrown anywhere in the country. And so I was supposed to continue in Achimota school, but my dad had decided to relocate the family in Tamale. And so if I continued to Achimota school, I was going to be the only one left here in Accra. So he opted to take me to secondary school in the north. And that's how come I went to Ghana Secondary School in Tamale. And I really haven't regretted that I attended that school. Teenagers in Tamale. I wore a huge Afro bell button trousers and heavy platform shoes. For those of you who don't know heavy platform shoes, it was the early 1970s, and that was the definition of cool. Black American culture had taken West Africa by storm. More accurately, there seemed to be a cultural exchange taking place between Black America and West Africa, especially Ghana. Black Americans had traded in their blue jeans, suits, and shirt sleeves for batiks, tie and dyes, and dashikis sewn from the popular Ghanaian cloth called Angelina. Meanwhile, we in Ghana had taken to wearing hipsters, miniskirts, tight polyester shirts that were left unbuttoned straight down to the navel. As funky as the fashion was, it was merely a byproduct. The music was the main event. The Jackson 5 mania was spreading throughout the continent like an infectious disease. Those brothers were our idols, the Jackson 5. We memorized their songs, we copied their dance moves, and actually we tried to dress like them. Everybody I knew wanted to be like Michael Jackson, and I was no exception. As luck would have it, I had more in common with Michael Jackson than any of those boys who purposely spoke in an awkwardly high fashion voice or stood in front of the mirror every morning and diligently picked their afros. For starters, we were almost the same age. Michael was only 3 months older than me to the day. His birth date was August 29, 1958, and mine was November 29, 1958. To children, small coincidences like this hold a great deal of weight and meaning. If the 1960s was a season of politics, then the 1970s was the season of song. The sounds of Motown and Stax Records filled the airwaves in Ghana with James Brown and the Jackson 5, Otis Redding, and many others. The passion that was once roused by our political leaders was now being channeled into song. The icons of the previous era had been executed and assassinated, exiled, imprisoned, or otherwise silenced. There was no Patrice Lumumba. There was no Sylvanus Olympio. There was no Kwame Nkrumah. There was no Abubakar Tafawa Balewa. There was no Nelson Mandela, he was in prison. There was no Martin Luther King. There was no Malcolm X. There was no Amilcar Cabral. There was only us and our music. Fela Anikulapo Kuti was gaining international recognition for his significant contributions to the sound that will forever be known as Afrobeat. There were many other sounds as well. There was Bumbaya. There was Hejole. And the sounds of the Uhuru dance band. A lot of bands used to tour throughout Ghana, traveling from town to town. Whenever one of the bands like Geraldo Pino and the Heartbeats was coming, the whole town would be agog. In 1971, there was the concert of all concerts, the Soul to Soul Music Festival, which was staged on a March 6th as a celebration of Ghana's 14th anniversary of independence. It was held in Accra at the Black Star Square. And it was 14 hours long, ending at dawn, Wilson Pickett, Ike and Tina Turner, the Staple Singers, Santana, and Roberta Flack. For months before and for months afterwards, Soul to Soul was the talk of the nation. Every town attempted their own mini replica of Soul to Soul, inviting multiple bands to try to pack the venues and keep the show going until the crowd was knackered. All the bands that came to Tamale usually performed at a place we called the Legion Village. Not many kids our age could afford the gate fee, but Dad would always give us money if we needed it, enough for us to be able to get in and buy a few drinks. My older brothers drank beer, but Adam and I stuck to water and minerals, or soft drinks, as they are commonly referred to in Ghana. The kids in Tamale, our friends, flocked to our house because there were so many of us. It was like a ready-made community. Also, they knew that we would always end up taking a few of our closest friends along with us to whatever performance or events that we were attending, even if it meant having to pay for them as well. This alone guaranteed that half of the town's kids were always hanging around at our house hoping to be chosen. Discos were also sprouting up all over the place. When there weren't any bands coming to town on Friday and Saturdays, my brothers and I would go to a disco. The most popular one in Tamale was the Right Spot Disco. The music would be so loud that you could feel the vibration of the beat in your chest cavity. Alfred, Adam, and Peter and I would dance, lifting and kicking those clunky platform shoes to perform all kinds of moves that we had seen on Soul Train. We enjoyed showing off to one another and just being silly and just generally having a nice time. My interest in the opposite sex was developing. So one of the highlights of going out to these performances and discos was the prospect of seeing a pretty girl. I had not graduated to the level of meeting them or even having a conversation. Unlike Peter. I admired his confidence. Peter was my elder brother. I admired his confidence and the sure stride that he would use to walk up to the girl he liked and wanted to start a conversation with. He had this way of standing and looking at a girl with a slight grin and his eyes like flags lowered at half mast. When Peter did that, any girl he was talking to would immediately melt. She would giggle foolishly and look away, pretending to be shy, but all the while making cat and mouse small talk with him. I was at that stage in my development where I could only stop and look. That's all I was physically capable of. If a girl I thought was pretty came to talk to me, I would find myself unable to speak, or the words that would manage to come out of my mouth would sound so silly and juvenile, and I would immediately regret having said them. When you're a teenager, music is like a previously undiscovered aperture, shining light on your interior. It permits you to explore the cavernous spaces of what world in which of that world in which you've never before dared to venture. Music speaks both to you and for you. It is a means of engagement and a form of rebellion. It teaches you how to hope. When they performed, the members of Oracle 74, that was the school band in which my brothers played, expressed themselves in a way that went beyond the music. They wore purple raincoats with iron gray helmets, tight blue shorts with rainbow stockings, long green dress with huge underwater style goggles, 6-inch high brown platform shoes, and white pirate style shirts. One band member was perpetually decked out in a newsboy cap. We called those caps Coolie High at the time. I'm sure you still know them. Which was the name of an American film. Coolie High was a film that had been shown at most of the cinemas. All the characters in the film wore that cap. Our stepmother then, Joyce Tamaklo, owned a boutique in Tamale where the members of the band, my brother's school band, used to shop for all their outlandish clothing. We were just teenagers growing up in Tamale. So that's the excerpt from. I will now take Praise for the Powerful. And it goes like this. When I was 16 and my third year, a new family moved in. Let me start from the beginning. Praise for the Powerful. Yentia is an Akan word that means we won't pay. When Colonel Ignatius Kutu Achampong came into power through a coup d'etat in 1972, this was his answer to the question of what to do about the outstanding national and international debt assumed from the previous administration. Yentia won't pay. Colonel Ike Achampong, as he was generally known, was Ghana's fifth head of state and its third military ruler. When he became the head of state, Achampong set up a governing body called the National Redemption Council, of which he was the leader. The constitution was suspended. All political activity was banned. And those whom Achampong felt were a threat to the state were placed in detention. Ghana found itself back where it had been so many years before, with the military cutting short the tenure of an elected leader instead of allowing democracy to take its course. Achampong considered himself a nationalist, something of a cultural revolutionary. His goal was to redeem the country, to see it gain self-sufficiency and achieve national unity. He started putting programs in place to meet that goal. And one of the first of these programs was Operation Feed Yourself, which had had such a direct and positive impact on my father when he first entered the business of agriculture. The political life had been a turbulent one, and now what my father craved was a quiet and eventful life with his family. The time he had spent in detention after the 1966 coup, having to live every hour of every day in a small confined space, gave him greater appreciation for the lush expanse of land he'd grown up with in the north. He craved space. He wanted space and freedom. He had built our home on an entire acre of land, and he had bought the plot right next to it to ensure that nothing and nobody ever caged him in again. Every day while we were living in Tamale, when Dad stepped outside to go to work, he would take a deep breath. He would suck in all the air his lungs could contain. And when he exhaled, it was like a sigh of relief, an expression of gratitude for his freedom. With the exception of the younger ones who were not yet ready, all the kids who lived with Dad attended boarding school. When we were home, we ambled through our days, working at the rice mill, spending time with Salifu the watchman, listening to music, going out to dance, or playing football with our friends. Our lives were uncomplicated, and the bare definition of normal that we knew. The plot on the other side of our house was occupied by the manager of the Ghana Commercial Bank. Public servants in Ghana were provided with accommodation. It only made bank managers come and go. While their positions were not permanent, they were long-term, lasting for as many as 3 years in any location. So the managers moved in with their families. The house next door, the one that the Ghana Commercial Bank manager lived in, had a wall around the property. The wall wasn't very high. We could see over it into their yard. But there was never really any reason to look. The managers were usually middle-aged, pot-bellied men with their wives. If they had children, they were often in university or grown up and living on their own. When I was 16 and in my third year at Ghana School, a new family moved in. We assumed they were like all the others. But one day asked my brother, my brothers and I were playing football with our friends. We looked over the wall and saw a boy. He was about our age. He was outside playing in their yard, kicking a football aimlessly. We called him over to join us. We'd been playing for about an hour or two when his sister came out to call him in. What I remember is that I was fully absorbed in the game. My eyes were keenly on the ball. I looked up for an instant, almost instinctively, and I saw this girl. She was beautiful. She was slender and dark-skinned. Everything about her glowed as though she were walking in her own spotlight. I tried to turn my attention quickly back to the game, but I couldn't. I felt funny, as if I were underwater, moving, but without precision. When my brother kicked the ball to me, I rushed to meet it. But I couldn't get there fast enough. I ended up fumbling and falling and giving way to somebody on the other team to take possession. "Ah, but what's your problem?" Alfred asked me. "That was a clear pass to you. It was yours." Thomas and I became friends. No, sorry, listen. Thomas, said the girl, rescuing me from the wrath of my brother. Mommy says you have to come home now. Hi, I said as she passed by me to get to her brother. Oh, hi, she responded, looking back at me. I watched her walk across our yard, which we turned into a makeshift field. I felt as though some powerful force had grabbed hold of my body and was pulling me even deeper underwater. My heart was beating fast. The other boys ignored her. They treated her like just the intrusion she was. Even her brother grumbled at her presence. He said his goodbyes to us, kicking the dirt as he walked back to their house. Thomas and I became friends, partly because we were about the same age, and he was good company, and partly because being around him gave me the opportunity to see his sister again. Her name was Alice, and I'd never felt the way I did when I was around her. I'd seen and met lots of pretty girls when my brothers and I went to the disco, but this was different. She was different. We hadn't ever said a word to each other beyond the hi and hello we exchanged when our paths crossed because of Thomas. But that was enough. It was enough to make me think of her all day and dream of her while I slept all night. When my father was released from detention, his assets had been frozen. Although he'd been able to purchase the plots he needed to build his house and start his farm due to the land tenure system in the north, which rested in the hands of the chiefs, getting his rice mill business off the ground was another matter altogether. He needed capital, and the only way he could do so was to secure a loan from the banks. Dad formed a limited liability company. He asked two of his friends to help him by signing the required forms. They were men who had their own lives and their own occupations. They had no interest at all in Dad's business. Dad had provided all the collaterals and everything else that was needed for the loan to be approved and the business to take off. He would take care of the day-to-day management and whatever else was needed for the business to run. His friends, the two other shareholders, were for all intents and purposes ghosts, names on a sheet of paper. During one of his visits to the north, General Champong imposed a ban on the importation of rice into Ghana in order to give the local farmers a chance. He asked the Bank of Ghana to give direct commodity loans to the rice mills so that they'll be able to purchase rice from the local farmers. Since my father was a rice farmer and also owned a rice mill, the ban and the Operation Feed Yourself program were especially beneficial to him. With the state essentially funding the purchase of raw materials, Ghana's rice industry was thoroughly revitalized. Achampong's vision was becoming a reality. Insofar as food was concerned, within a short period of time, Ghana had become self-sufficient and was now even entering the export market to sell its surplus rice to other African countries. Whenever Kenna Achampong traveled to the north, he would stop by our house to personally greet my father. The two were not close friends, but they had a cordial relationship, one based on respect and necessity. Because of Operation Feed Yourself, my father's rice mill was of strategic interest to the state. My father, much to his own surprise, liked General Achampong, Colonel Achampong. The colonel was a military man, a coup maker, and that alone could have easily kept him out of my father's good graces. But Dad believed that Colonel Achampong, despite the way he came into office, had Ghana's best interest at heart. He was making improvements and effecting change in the country. Achampong had switched Ghana's system of measurements from the imperial to the metric. In 1974, through another of his programs, Operation Keep Right, Ghana switched from driving on the left side of the road to driving on the right. Many of you who are young would never know that we used to drive on the left, to driving on the right. It was perhaps one of the most successful radio and television advertising campaigns in the history of Ghana. A taxi driver would blow his horn four times at another taxi driver. Beep, 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 beep. Then the first driver would lean out of his window and say the slogan, Nifa, Nifa, Na Nyen. This in Akan means right, right. That is it. For those of you who are old enough, you remember any funny funny. My father used to tell us of General Achampong's accomplishment. He was impressed. There was no denying it. One day he decided to sit down and write to Achampong, who had recently promoted himself from colonel to general. My dad believed in commending people for a job well done. It was a habit he'd formed while still a young man working as a teacher. It was a habit that we, his children, benefited from. E.A. Mahama was never one to withhold praise. He gave it freely when he felt it was due. Though he was writing this letter to General Achampong as a private citizen, he decided to offer him a bit of insight he'd gleaned from his years as a politician. In the letter he wrote, Dad told General Achampong that he had done an admirable job thus far as head of state and had proven himself to be an asset to the country. He reminded General Achampong that in politics, there often comes a time when the pendulum starts to swing the other way. It might be prudent, my father advised, given his current popularity and success of his various programs, if the head of state started to give some thought to when he would lift the ban on party politics and transition the country back to constitutional rule. If he properly planned and timed his departure from politics, my father continued, General Achampong would surely be remembered as one of Ghana's most effective leaders. Quotation marks, remember to leave, my dad wrote, when the applause is the loudest. While Dad was writing his letter to General Achampong, I was writing my own letter. It was a letter to Alice, the girl who lived next door. After several weeks of playing football together nearly every afternoon, Thomas and I had eased into a friendship. I was older than him by a year or two, and so he looked up to me and was always happy to be in my company. Peter, Alfred, and our friend Joe Mara would join us for football, but outside of the pitch, they ignored Thomas. After our matches, they would go off and do their own thing, and we will also go off and do ours. One afternoon while we were sitting and talking on the veranda, I confessed to Thomas that I thought his sister was the most beautiful girl I'd ever seen. He looked at me strangely, as though I'd suddenly started talking in a language he couldn't understand. He must have found me silly. This was, after all, his big sister. It had probably never crossed his mind that anybody could think of her in that way. If one of my friends had told me he thought one of my sisters was beautiful, I'd have had to stop and reconsider his sanity. But Alice mesmerized me. Every time I saw her, my mind would take leave of my body. I'd trip over my own feet, or I'd walk into the hedges. All I wanted to do was to stare at her. Her skin was smooth, her cheeks were high and pronounced, and especially when she smiled. I'd invent reasons to go and see Thomas, just so I could place myself in Alice's path. So telling Thomas how I felt about his sister was such a huge relief. With the exception of that you can't be serious look he gave me, Thomas didn't respond to what I had confessed. A few days later, from out of nowhere, he said, "But you should tell Alice." My reaction was visceral. My heart pounded one big time, really hard. Then it jumped into my throat. I shook my head so violently, it's a wonder my head didn't fall off. Me? Thomas, stand in front of Alice and actually say something, and not just say something, but I think she's beautiful. Then I'll do it for you, Thomas responded. When he said that, I thought I would drop dead right there and then. What is this boy trying to do to me? I didn't even want to consider how Alice might respond. a girl that beautiful had to already have a boyfriend, you know. It reminded me of when Alfred and I used to go to the Simple Full Moon dance at Damango, and Alfred and the village boys his age had started liking girls. When the dance started, each of them would choose a girl he thought was the prettiest and become fixated with her. They would stare and swoon, and then inevitably the girls would choose other partners for the evening, and it wouldn't be one of them. The rejection would hurt the boys so deeply that they wore the pain of rejection on their faces, not really understanding why they should be feeling the way they were. I didn't want to know that kind of rejection. And I definitely didn't want to walk around with that look of pain plastered on my face. No, I said again to Thomas, no, 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 no. I was thinking how much I regretted ever telling him when he said, but you know, I think she likes you too. Eh, she does? You think this news would have made me ecstatic, but it rather frightened me. No girl had ever liked me before. Not that I knew of anyway. So what was supposed to happen next? When it came to meeting girls, my brother Peter was the pro. I wondered if I should ask Peter for advice. Write her a letter, Thomas said. At first, I refused. But the more I thought about it as the day wore on, the more I decided that maybe it wasn't such a bad idea after all. Writing a letter wasn't like talking to someone face to face. When it came to talking to girls, Peter had no fear. I wasn't like that. In letters, you could tell people what you wanted to say, and they could interpret it in their own time and in their own way. I decided to do it, to write Alice a letter. Dear Alice, how are you? It was a very short letter. I think you are very beautiful. And I love you 99.9%. Take good care, John. Finish. It was more a note than a letter. Thomas and I snuck into my stepmother Joyce's room, where she kept her clothing, jewelry, and perfume. We sprayed and sniffed the different scents. from each bottle until we found the one we thought Alice would like. It smelled like lemon, overripe mango mixed with honey. We doused the paper with perfume, waving it in the air after each spray so that the ink on the words wouldn't bleed or smudge. When it was dry, we folded the paper over once, twice, and a third time, and then we slid it into an envelope. We then sprayed more perfume on the envelope. Thomas hand carried the letter to Alice. The whole night, my stomach was like soup, like a soup stirring with anxiety and hope and prayer and fear and desire. The next day, neither Thomas nor Alice emerged from their house. I was disheartened. I took it personally. She hated the letter. I knew it. She probably hated me too by now. And Thomas was too ashamed to come and tell me. I decided I wasn't going to show my face outside again for the remainder of the long vacation. I didn't want to chance seeing either of them. The next day, Thomas came over with apologies. They'd left early in the morning with their parents to attend a funeral in Kumasi and hadn't returned until late that night. He handed me an envelope that looked similar to the one I'd given him to deliver to Alice. I took it thinking she was returning my letter unopened and unread. Then I saw my name written on the envelope in a handwriting I did not recognize. I could also now smell the perfume that had been sprayed onto that envelope. It wasn't the same kind Thomas and I had used on hers. This one was sweet-scented like toffee, vanilla, and caramel. I ripped open the envelope, my hands shaking. I removed the paper and started to read. Dear John, I am fine. How are you two? I think you are cute. And I like you to 99.9%. Alice, I was elated. She really did like me. Thomas hadn't just said that to make me feel good or to tease me, because after all, she was his sister. After Thomas left, I sprawled on the bed and read the letter over and over and over again. After reading, I lay it over my face and inhaled the perfume. I looked at Alice's handwriting, which was neat and feminine, filled with lots of loops and squiggly lines. I looked at the creases in the letter where she had folded the paper, and I imagined her gentle hands gliding along, folding the paper to secure them so that the paper would lie flat. It is not unreasonable for someone to believe that he could lead his country better than the individual in power, who more often than not is not an elected official. That is the purpose of the electoral process. The reason why there's an opportunity at the end of every official term for him or her to be challenged. That is why there's a platform for candidates to campaign, to share their thoughts, their strengths and leadership ability, as well as their vision for the future with voters. It takes a certain type of personality, however, to believe that he can do better and then to circumvent the electoral process through a forceful acquisition of power, denying the people their right to choose their own leader. This sort of self-aggrandizement becomes more and more apparent as the coup maker, already having taken power, attempts to elevate themselves even further and further. Several years after his 1965 coup in the Democratic Republic of Congo, Joseph Désiré Mobutu, a military man in his youth, changed his name to Mobutu Sese Seku Nkuku Ngbendu Wazabanga. Quick translates to the all-powerful warrior who, because of his endurance and inflexible will to win, will go from conquest to conquest, leaving fire in his wake. Mobutu also affixed his image on the country's postage stamps and currency. In 1969, after the coup in Libya, Colonel Muammar al-Gaddafi declared that he was the leader of all Arab leaders and the king of kings in Africa and the imam of all Muslims. He rejected the titles of head of state or president and instead adopted the official title of brother leader. So he was brother leader, guide of the first September Great Revolution of the Socialist People's Libyan Arab Jamahiriya, Muammar Gaddafi. In 1971, after the coup in Uganda, then Major General Idi Amin promoted himself to Field Marshal. He then assumed the title, His Excellency, President for Life, Field Marshal Alhaji Dr. Idi Amin Dada. Uganda's military leader then started bestowing numerous and end titles and decorations upon himself, such as CBE, Conqueror of the British Empire, VC, Victoria Cross, DSO, Distinguished Service Order, and MC, Military Cross. By the end of his tenure, his complete self-giving title had become His Excellency President for Life, Field Marshal Alhaji, Dr. Idi Amin Dada, VC, DSO, MC, CBE, Lord of all the beasts of the earth and fishes of the sea, and Conqueror of the British Empire in Africa in general and in Uganda in particular. In many ways, it felt as though Achampong was going in the same direction, his self-promotion from colonel to general being but one example. The problem with coming into power by force is that it breeds a certain paranoia. Military rulers and dictators find it difficult to trust anyone. They fear for their safety, believing perhaps rightly so, that just as they had forcibly removed others from power, there are people who would also like to see them forcibly removed from power. So that's the excerpt I took from Praise for the Powerful. And I think my 1 hour is up. So I'll leave it there. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Your Excellency. It was very fascinating listening to you. If there's one thing we know about the former president, it is that he's always up to date with social trends. And so his afro hair, bell-bottom trousers, and heavy platform shoes from his teenage days, Tamale's proof of this. So I would invite questions and comments from students and other invited guests.
If the House doesn't reach it to our students, some of whom I believe have read the book, I know that by a very important coincidence, at least one of the classes had listed right from the beginning of the semester that they were going to read and discuss this book this week.
About the last decades of Africa. And in most of our classes, especially in economics, they always blame what happened partly on the international financial institutions, the IMF and the World Bank. So my question is, what's your take on the structural adjustment programs during those periods? As a historian, but also as a former president of Ghana, how did you deal with the pressure, partly from the financial institutions, but then from your own electorates? Most of the time, the recommendations from those institutions might be against what your electorates want. So I'm wondering what it was like having to deal with these pressures.
In one of our previous autobiographies we studied, we realized that Ikweno had issues with the extent of truth in it. I'd like to know what's the level of fiction and what's the level of truth, certainty, or if there were any fiction at all, because some of them are memoirs, so how much it was. Secondly, when we read about Kwame Nkrumah, we realized that there was this argument that he tried to extol himself, but then from his readings, we realized that he took a very calm demeanor. Also being a politician, didn't he fear that coming from a very privileged background, which is against what we normally read, could have gone against him? Thank you.
That's a complicated question, but
as a creative writing student, my question has to do with the style. Was it intentional to fuse reading or listening to you? You noticed a lot of different styles have been fused in one. First, you notice you are telling a story, your personal story, and then there's the story of Ghana or Africa. And then there's also this very jovial, fun style to it. How did you, as a writer, manage to fuse all these seemingly difficult individual styles to produce a perfect blend?
I know for writing autobiographies, you are chronicling like your entire like life experiences, and there's bound to be memory lapses at some point in time. So when you were writing your autobiography, how did you deal with these memory lapses, and who or what did you rely on for sources, especially for incidents and situations where you were not present yourself? And again, how did you verify the truth of this, the truth of the stories that they tell you, or that's what I'd like to know.
Thank you very much. I like to speak standing. It's both from my days as a teacher and also as a politician. Let me start with the first question, that is on structural adjustment and international financial institutions. Very fantastic question. In the 70s and 80s, in the period that I refer to as the Lord's decades, African countries economically fell into the doldrums. Indeed, our economies were not growing, they were contracting. In the early 80s, Ghana's economy, we're used to 4% growth, 5% growth today. In those days, it was minus one, minus two. And so the economies were not growing, they were rather contracting. And so many countries, including our own country, Ghana, you know, had to go to the international monetary institutions to be able to put the economies back on a path of growth. Our country has come a long way since then. The international financial institutions have also come a long way since then. Kenneth Kaunda said, the IMF is like a mad doctor. It can only dispense one prescription, quinine. And for those of you who know quinine, it's the bitterest medicine you'll ever encounter on earth. And so that's all the IMF knew to do, give you quinine. If you have malaria, drink quinine. And so they came with all kinds of stringent, you know, benchmarks you had to meet. You had to cut subsidies on everything. Subsidies to healthcare, subsidies to education, subsidies to agriculture, everything. Their theory was that African agriculture should learn to compete with agriculture in the rest of the world. And that you should only give subsidies if you can afford the subsidies, and you can't take somebody's money and subsidize your farmers. And so our farmers had to compete with farmers who were being subsidized in the advanced countries. And so that was the situation in which we existed. But Ghana had to go through it, take the bitter medicine, and then make some adjustments. And so it was in those years that the CD was left to float. Foreign exchange bureaus were introduced. Forex bureaus were introduced. It was those days that there was a policy, they called it, where students had to contribute with governments for their education. Cost sharing. Those were the beginnings of cost sharing and all that. And then those were the beginnings of cash and carry in the health sector. You had to pay before you were given service. So it created quite hardship, a lot of hardship in Africa. And aside from that, it created new classes of poverty. More people fell, you know, into the poverty trap. I must say that those financial institutions have changed since then. They accept that there must be strong social protection programs in any adjustments program that you are conducting. And so when we started this last program, in which Ghana still is currently with the IMF, one of the areas that they benchmark is how much money is going into social protection, how much money is going into livelihood empowerment against poverty programs. And in those early days, they had started to realize the new growing class of poor people. And so they found, they were thinking of a way to ameliorate it. And Ghana was one of the examples they tried to use. And so they came up with a program they call PAMSCAD. I don't know how many of you heard of PAMSCAD. But those were the days of acronyms. We had a lot of acronyms, you know, and PAMSCAD was one of them. And PAMSCAD meant Program of Action to Mitigate the Social Cost of Adjustment, you know. And so under PAMSCAD, they gave some trucks. They made sure that some food assistance was given to the very poor families and so on and so forth. But today, I must say that there are many social protection programs. You have the livelihood empowerment against poverty. And probably our most successful social protection program is the National Health Insurance Scheme, from which, you know, as many as 12 million subscribers benefit, you know, from free health care upon payment of a certain premium. And so we have several, like the school feeding program, that's a social protection program, ensuring that, you know, children are able to get one meal a day, a nutritious meal, so that they are not stunted and their nutrition is good. You know, and there are several other such programs that we are implementing, which in the past the IMF would not allow you to. But now they encourage you to, and probably even give money to be put in some of those programs. So that's what happened in those days. You see, in what is, how much truth and how much fiction? Normally, when you write a book, the story is a story, and it's based on truth. But based on the style, you must have some humor, you must have, you know, inject all kinds of things that make it interesting to read. My intention, and upon the advice of my editor, was to make it an easy read. You can write an autobiography like a textbook. And so that means somebody has to take it and really concentrate on studying like he's studying a textbook. But I wanted people to just relax and enjoy the story. And so the core of the book is fact. But if I exaggerate about clunky platform shoes, it's just, you know, added to make you capture, you know, what we looked at. It's even like laughing at ourselves. Because when I look at the pictures of us in those days, I laugh. Why would you go and wear these, you know, these blocks on your feet, you know? And then we had this huge afro hair. You had it took us 10 minutes to finish combing. We had these special combs, afro combs, we call them. And you stand and pick, you know, segment by segment. Now I have a haircut every week. I don't bother to run any comb through my hair and I'm fine. But there's a lot of humor in it. I remember I wrote a letter. I don't remember if I wrote 99.9%. But in those days, I mean, it was standard, you know, love letter to put 99%, you know. So that's what it was meant to be. The way the book is structured, too, in terms of style, is to make it easy. Although the chapters are interwoven and trace my life through that period, each chapter stands on its own. So if you take Providence, or you take Tavarish, or you take Ghana Must Go, or you take Teenagers in Tamale, or you take Praise for the Powerful, it tells its own complete story. But then at the same time, there's a linkage and an interweaving of all the chapters together to tell the full story. And so that's the style that was used. Different people have different opinions about Nkrumah, but I mean, certainly one thing we can't run away from is that he's the founder of our nation. He led the independence struggle. Many people contributed, and it happens in Christianity. There's John the Baptist, there's all the apostles and everybody, but who is the champion of Christianity? Jesus Christ. So we don't undermine the role other people played. Sergeant Ajete, all of them, everybody played a role. My dad and co were the organizers in the northern parts, and sang heroes, going from town to town, organizing, you know, the people and agitating them. But you cannot recognize all those who took part. There's that person who gave the critical spark that eventually led to independence. And you cannot run away from it. It's Dr. Kwame Nkrumah. So that's it. And for me, Nkrumah is a hero. And I believe that one of the things he tried to do was to build the infrastructure of this country and use it as a platform to industrialize the country. I believe that his vision was far ahead of the country itself. And so most of us didn't understand what he was trying to do. But today, when we look back, we can see, you know, what he was trying to make of this country. But of course, there are as varied opinions as there are human beings in Ghana about the role that Dr. Nkrumah played. Privileged background, yes, I haven't hidden it in the book. My dad started as a teacher. And I always thank God for who I am, because I'm what I am by a fate of accident. In this story, you see the district commissioner's hat and how my dad ended up going to school because he was standing outside his grandfather's palace. His grandfather was the chief, and he had a big navel. And the district commissioner was passing, and he squeezed my father's navel. And of course, it's painful. And so my father lashed out, and the district commissioner's hat fell. And so he picked it and took a look at the boy, cleaned his hat, and he went into my grandfather's hat. And so what the colonial government did was to go to the chiefs and take the children of the chiefs. And if you didn't give your child, you were destooled. You were removed as chief. So they were coming. They came to Bole, which is the hometown where we come from. But my grandfather was the chief of a smaller village. And so they went to the Bolera and said, we're coming to take one of your children to go to school. And because he's a divisional chief, he can delegate to another one. So he said, no, go to Bimfura and go and take Bimfura's son. And that was my grandfather. And so that's how come the district commissioner went to my grandfather's palace and said, Bolera said I should come and take one of your children to school. And he said, oh, no, my children are all grown. They are married. They are gone where. He says, oh, but I know who I want. He says, who? He says, that small boy outside with a big navel. And he said, no, that's my grandchild. It's not my son. He said, doesn't matter whether it's your son or it's your grandson. I'm taking him to school. And so he asked them to prepare him. If they didn't send him, they would destroy him. And so my grandfather had to agree. And so on the day they came and took the boy away and sent him to school, and that's how he became educated. And so he was sent back to our hometown to open the first school in Bole. And when he came and was a teacher in Bole, still people were reluctant to send their children to school. So he took his siblings and his nephews and nieces and things and brought them into the school. And one of his sisters and nephews and things is Joyce Mukhtari's mother, who my father taught, put in school and educated. She became a very renowned educationist, you know, later. So he left politics and went into business and was very successful in business. And so that had been my intention in 2008. I thought I was leaving politics and also going into the private sector. But like I said, God guides our steps, and I am where I am today. Talking about the style again, that is, I'm a historian. My first degree was in history. And so in deciding on what style to use, I was talking about the lost decades of Africa, and it was necessary to create reference markers for people throughout the book about the era in history in which not only Ghana was, but Africa and the world. And so you find that in every story, I pause and talk about what stage in history, you know, we're talking about. It's either the Cold War, or this was happening, or there was this war taking place, or that. They were just meant as reference markers, and it just comes out of my natural tendency, or my natural my training as a historian, and that's why I infused history into the book. Writing the book, how did you fill gaps in your memory? And I tell you, there were many gaps. A lot of the stories I tell are based on my father's narration to me. Growing up, we were quite close to him. And so, especially if you read the parts with the tea time, he comes from work and then he, you know, makes his tea. He was like a typical Englishman. And you were privileged to be invited to come and sit with him and drink tea in the afternoon at 3 o'clock. And he'll sit with you, and while drinking tea, he'll be talking about things that have happened and all that. And as one of the good boys, very well behaved, and so I enjoyed the privilege more than most of my brothers in sitting with him and drinking tea and listening to his stories. And then after I went into politics, you know, because I was the one who took after his footsteps and went into politics, then he started to, you know, give me a lot of stories about his political life, his experiences and things. And so a lot of the book is from my father's stories that were told to me. But where there were gaps, like in the early years, how he went to school and all that, I had heard the stories, I had been told the stories, but to get a precise understanding of what happened, then I referred to his brothers. And so my uncle, Wablura, is one of those who was very helpful, you know. So where there were gaps in my memory of, you know, the stories he had told me, my uncles were there to give me more precision in what had actually happened. My brothers too were also very helpful. And so when the manuscript was being developed and I came and spoke here, we did several readings. My brothers were with me, and they started referring to the book as our book. So how is our book? And so I want to say that it is actually not my book, it's our book. Because my brothers, my uncles, and everybody, you know, actually really gave me a lot of help in terms of refreshing my memory about a lot of the things that happened. I think I've adequately answered the questions. Thank you.
When I heard the president wrote his book, It inspired me, and I've also written one. I only heard that he's launching the book on the radio this morning, and I ran to come and buy two copies, one for myself and one for a friend police officer. My book is here. This is just the script. Some pictures are going into the book. They haven't gone to the book yet. So during the time of my lunch, I may not invite him. If he also hears about the lunch, he can come. And my book is on a topic which is controversial. Fighting corruption in Ghana. My picture is at the back. Just to show it, I'm still pregnant. I've not delivered it yet. And his brother, Ibrahim, is my friend. So even if I don't invite him, I bought two of your books. I know you very well. Yeah, look at it. Show it to them. My picture is at the back. Yes. I was in the police 35 years, 6 months. I'm 72 years old. So all what I did in Ghana police is what I wrote in the book.
You mentioned that you are working on a second book. I would like to find out from you how far you've gone with that book, and if indeed you've now abandoned the political ambition to concentrate on writing books. And also, if you would want to add, I would want to find out from you how many copies you've sold. Thank you very much, Your Excellency.
Thank you. As a wife and a mother, yes. As a wife and a mother, I'm curious about the fact that you don't make much mention of your mom. Mm. I haven't read the book, so I really don't know whether it's a fact or not. But I get the impression that not much mention is made of your mom, and I'm just curious about the reason.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. Those are our questions. Let me congratulate our senior citizen for putting his thoughts into a book. Like I said, I think that many more of us should write. And unfortunately, because of the computer age and our interaction with all the e-devices, we don't have any more time to take an actual book and sit, you know, for a few hours and just enjoy, you know, your imagination, you know, building a story of what the words are. And so I do believe that people in all walks of life, you know, can put down their memories. It doesn't need to be a huge book. It can be a small book. It can be a pamphlet. It can be something. When I started this book, I didn't know it would come to that number of pages, because right from the beginning, I had just about three stories or three chapters. And I said, oh, well, this is enough for a book, you know. And Bloomsbury and my editor said, Nana, you're nowhere near a book yet. But I said, we're in a meeting with our senior editor in Bloomsbury, and we had reached almost 100 pages or something like that. And I said, in Ghana, this is a book. He says, no, if you want to publish internationally, this is not a book yet. And so we had to add on and add on until we got the full story out. I actually was going to end it after my teenage years and, you know, from when I went to university. But I continued and cataloged my years in this institution and in Commonwealth Hall. I'm a vandal. And one of the things I said was that Commonwealth Hall made me who I am, because it charted the course of my growing up. I entered Commonwealth Hall, a very shy young man. And I came out a more expressive, confident person. And that is what armed me to go into politics. And so I owe and so I owe a lot to Commonwealth Hall. Then I wrote the part about my stay in Russia, because on this campus I was a very strong socialist, and I belonged to a socialist cell. Tichibo Minu and others were all our socialist mentors. And so I went to Russia, you know, to do my postgraduate. And in Russia, I came, you know, to a certain realization that there's no absolute truth in any ideology, and that you must build things based on the peculiar experiences of the circumstance in which you are, not in an ideology that is imposed on any particular groups of people. And so that's one of my very favorite chapters. It's called Tavarish. Tavarish in Russian means comrade. And so that's another chapter that I like very much. But the book was launched in 2012. Like I said, in 6 states in the US. We didn't get to do the Ghana launch because, as Prof said, when I returned on a Friday, and the tragic event of Professor Mills passing happened on the following Tuesday. And since I got sworn in as president, I never got the opportunity to launch the book, even though we had intended to launch it in many other places in Africa. It says I'm working on a second book. Yes, I have some manuscripts that I've been trying to work on. As president, I didn't have enough time, but I've taken it off the shelf where it was for several months. I've dusted it off, and I'm looking at it again. It takes quite a while. It took 3 years to write this book, and so it's not an easy task, especially if you're not a full-time writer. And so you have to balance out other engagements together with writing. And so don't expect that it's coming out anytime soon. And if it's a book that tells a political story, then you often want to wait till many of the actors are dead and gone before you come out and say wicked things about them. But certainly. How many copies has the book sold? I don't know. It's the publishers who keep the records. The writer doesn't keep the records. So Bloomsbury would be the one to know. And there are many book agents, and so it means you have to gather the numbers. The book has been published in Portuguese. There's a Portuguese version. And we launched it in Brazil. And so if you go to the Portuguese-speaking countries, there's a publisher who has also published the Portuguese version of the book. About my mom, yes, you're right. There are many chapters that capture my relationship with my mother. And I actually explain in the book how come I got closer to my father than my mother. And that is because we grew up in my father's house. The North is a very paternalistic society. And so my father gathered all of us into the same house. So even if we were in the North, we don't say half brothers. Your brother is your brother, whether you're from the same mother or not. And so even though we're from different mothers, we all were brought into the same house, and we grew up together under my father's tutelage, together with whichever stepmother was installed in the house at the time. And so admittedly, my brothers on my father's side, we have a closer bond than even my brothers on my mother's side. After my mother broke up with my father, she had other children. But I must admit that I'm closer to my paternal brothers than I am to. It's just the fact of how we grew up. And so that's it. But I speak about my mom and my early days with her until she moved me to my father's house. There's an interesting part of the book that I tell with regards to how we came to my dad's house. We are 19 siblings, mostly boys. 12 of us are boys. And Often dad will go to work, and if a child had reached the stage where they should go to school, he would send for them and they would deliver him to his office. And then when he comes home, the child will be seated with his bag at the back. That's how I arrived in my father's house. And then the children who are installed in the house already will rush, say, hey, daddy, 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 daddy. Then he opened the door. He's called John. That's your brother. Take him to your room. And that's it. They led you to your room. They asked you, where are you from? Asked you all kinds of silly questions, you know. But society was different at the time. I mean, polygamy was a fact of life, you know, and, you know, it's not the same today. Today, you go have some child somewhere and bring to your house, your wife will slap you and order you to go back, you know, where the child came from. But those were the facts of life at the time. And I tried to tell the story as factually as it is and with all the humor that I could master. Thank you very much.